Comedy songwriting. So everybody go ahead and
do some
Comedies and music.
Sounds like something
you could
do.
People who are allegedly from
you got the music. You just
need
this is actually
I'm gonna be honest with you. I've been on the JoCo cruises for 4 years now. Speak up. Are you kidding?
Do you know what a microphone does?
There we go. So I've been on the JoCo cruise for 4 years now, and I've actually always wanted to have this particular panel because I have so many questions for these people. So I'm actually going to have them very quickly introduce themselves. It's inconceivable that you don't know who they are, but in case you've just wandered in and somehow got a membership without knowing anything about anyone, starting at the end in the lovely red shirt, go.
I'm Storm DiCostanzo. I am a fake tech speaker, musician, writer, producer, CFO.
I'm Paul Sabourin, and I'm sitting next to Jonathan Coulton. That's not necessarily a positive or a negative, just a fact.
I'm Jonathan Coulton, and I have my own fan cruise, bitches.
I'm Molly Lewis, I play the ukulele and write songs, and I have a bachelor's degree in English.
I'm Eban Schletter, and I write funny songs and write music for TV shows. That's my day.
Yeah. I have a theory that comedy songwriting is a little bit like Ginger Rogers. And the discussion there is that Ginger Rogers was famously said that she does everything that Fred Astaire does backwards and wearing heels. And what this means is that when you are a comedy songwriter, not only do you have to do the basic thing that songwriters do, which is write a song people want to listen to, but then you also have to do it amusingly. And so the very first question that I wanted to ask is the super basic question of how did you actually end up being a comedy songwriter or a humorous songwriter, because there's a little bit of a difference of those, instead of just necessarily someone who's writing songs. How did you get from writing songs into the humor aspect of it? So anyone can start, Jonathan.
I'm just thinking back. You know, the first song I ever wrote was a very sad song about staring at a window covered with frost and feeling sad. And it wasn't funny in any way. That was the very first song I wrote. And then I think I ended up I was kind of a fan of a few different people who used humor in a kind of dark and interesting and revealing way. Like they might be giants. Loudon Wainwright was another big influence. The idea that you could take a subject and make it kind of quirky and write something that was funny, sort of, but also, you know, like the larger shape is sad, maybe, or the larger shape is meaningful, but there are moments in there that are kind of funny and speak to that larger shape. Unique way. So that, I don't know, I always liked that in a song, and so when I started writing songs, that's the stuff that I tried to do.
For myself, Storm and I have generally written songs together for, Jesus, over 20 years at this point. We were part of an a cappella group called Da Vinci's Notebook. Thank you. We were originally just a pickup hobby group. We sang doo-wop songs and covers, and some of the covers we sang were funny songs by groups like the Bobs. And people responded the best to those songs, and so we wanted to do more of them. And we started, the first song I ever wrote was for Da Vinci's Notebook, and it was a comedy song. And it was, again, just from, you know, it's not like I went to school for it other than being a really deep fan of those types of songs by people. Weird Al, obviously, Tom Lehrer, Alan Sherman, and a whole bunch of other groups like that. And it was not so much out of necessity, so much as out of give me more of this thing, this positive feedback that we're getting. And that's how we got into the comedy aspect of songwriting, for me at least.
Yeah, no, that's pretty much it. It was, hey, this is working, let's do more of that.
I've always written comedy songs for as long as I've been writing songs, because it's kind of the only way I know how to express myself. Because I was learning ukulele, and before that, banjo, and before that, mandolin, and before that, guitar. And sort of tripping all the failure switches that led me to learning ukulele. I was covering other people's songs, and it hadn't occurred to me that... I certainly had the, like, someone should write a song about this Lisa Nowak person. That's fascinating. So Jonathan Coulton should write that song. But there was some point when I wrote, like, a terrible slam poem about MySpace and went, well, this is a terrible slam poem. This is not up to snuff. Wait, what if I set it to music? And that's where my MySpace song came from. And I really actually admire songwriters that don't have to be super literal. I'm not very good at writing figuratively, and like the kind of song that John Roderick writes seem like magic to me. I don't understand how you can be so not, how you can be so figurative in a song. But comedy songwriting is kind of the only songwriting I know how to do.
For me, I just like writing all kinds of different stuff. Instrumental stuff, serious songs, funny songs, and what happened with me is when I was in high school, I was in a punk rock band, and we were very obnoxious, and it just kind of came naturally for us to write really obnoxious songs. So then I was in a band with people that were comedians, Greg Barron and Laura Milligan, and they moved to L.A. and brought me to L.A., and I started, they would do comedy shows and also do music, and so I was just in and around that scene, and... So I just started working with all these people and writing songs and doing scoring for their sketches and stuff like that. And I didn't realize that it wasn't like I consciously chose it, but, you know, all the while I was listening to stuff like Spike Jones and Tom Lehrer also, enjoying all that. I wasn't really thinking that that's what I would do, but that's where I ended up, so.
Jonathan, I want to actually come back to something that you were talking about. You mentioned that... you would write a song and the overall mode would be kind of sad, but individual aspects of it would be funny or something like that. One of the things that I think is really interesting is I do think that you are generally classified as a humorous songwriter, but sometimes it's not that the songs are necessarily funny in and of themselves, but often that the subject matter is a little off kilter. And I'll give two examples of that. One is On Your Moon, which I think is just a tremendous, tremendous love song. It just happens to be about Pluto and Charon, who are, you know, no longer planets. And then the song that you wrote about Laika, the dog.
And the one called Space Doggity?
Space Doggity. Space Doggity.
It's an unfortunate title, I still regret it.
Not a great title, but the song is not actually humorous at all.
No.
But be that as it may, because of the nature of the subject of the song, it kind of gets classified as humor. Would you kind of agree that that is an aspect of what you do?
Well, yeah, and I think that the, you know, it's funny. I do this radio show, this quiz show on NPR called Ask Me Another. Degree. Okay. And we recorded in Brooklyn at this venue called the Bell House, and before we start recording, Ophira, the host, does a little stand-up, and I come out and do a song for everybody. And what I've discovered is that I don't actually have that many songs that work as comedy songs, because like Paul and Storm, when you are, you know, when you're coming out cold and playing something in front of an audience, the easiest thing to do is to play a song that is funny and that makes people laugh. And there are only a few, there are only a handful of songs that I have that can come out cold and read as funny, because the rest of them are kind of, just kind of weird and sad. So I think it's true. I think there is kind of a question about what is comedy music exactly mean? And, you know, I don't necessarily think of myself as a comedy musician as much as I think of myself as a, you know, I definitely write about odd subjects, and I definitely use comedic elements, But it's not as though I very rarely set out to write a song that is funny. But like Molly, it's sort of how I end up expressing myself a lot of the time. It seems like the most convenient way to express a feeling or a character's state of mind sometimes is by telling a joke that reveals something about them.
Molly, I see you moving your hand towards.
No, I was just thinking that kind of speaks to the They Might Be Giants influence that all of us have. Is like James K. Polk is not necessarily a funny song, but it's funny that somebody wrote a song like that
right.
About James K. Polk. Or about an ant crawling up your back in the nighttime or something.
But that's a great example. It's a very sincere song about James K. Polk.
Yeah.
But it's a ridiculous
You really
idea.
Feel for him when he doesn't pursue a second term.
Right.
Huh.
But it is. That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. He sought no second term, and it's very.
Having done all this.
It's very moving.
Yeah.
It's very moving. And that's a great example. It's because it's the idea of writing a song about James K. Polk is very funny, but the song itself is just sincere.
Yeah.
Evan, when you were writing for. Like, you've written songs for SpongeBob, for example.
Yes.
Yes.
If you don't think you know Eban.
Yeah, absolutely. And that seems like another example of the context of it is humorous, because obviously it's an ambulatory talking sponge.
Right.
To begin. But when you are writing the songs themselves, are you necessarily like hunting for the joke?
Well, in the case of SpongeBob, it's very depends on show to show what my involvement is. In their case, a lot of times I'm not even writing the lyrics; they give them to me.
Right.
Some of them I am writing the lyrics. They'll just go, "Hey, we need a song about Mr. Krabs feeling old." Sorry about the song about him being old.
I remember that song.
So that's one of the ones I did write lyrics for. And that one is just sort of they already have the situation; they actually already have it boarded.
Right.
And you have to fit it within that.
Right.
And a lot of times it's even with the lyrics, which can be very difficult because. Some people give you lyrics and you go, oh, wait, there's four lines and they rhyme. Some of them are like, okay, two rhyme and then there's one and then, So then you have to figure out a way through it. So it really depends on what your sort of assignment is, how far you're reaching for jokes. SpongeBob, in that particular show, I don't have that much freedom in terms of what, I'm not really coming up with a joke in terms of, it's already I'm either elaborating on it. But I did a show called Drawn Together, and that was one where they kind of let me just go. Thank you. You have guts applauding the most offensive show in television. And I guess I have guts admitting I wrote all those songs and lyrics and tapped into that punk rock idiot. To be juvenile and scatological and obnoxious. And on that one, they asked me when I first got it, do you want to write lyrics or anything? Can I do it both ways, whatever you guys want? They go, why don't you write a couple and we'll see. So I wrote, they had a couple lyrics started for Black Chick's Tongue. And another song, they just needed a peppy tune in this episode that has a monster vagina. So I wrote a song called La 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 Labia. So I said, okay, you can write the lyrics. And so just so there, it was a matter of just being silly and obnoxious and tapping into that punk rock sense and trying to make the guys laugh, which was really fun too. Just that was kind of a rare circumstance for me, where there was less filters of. I just kind of let them deal with any network issues because they were dealing with it so much anyway. They were pushing it on so many of the things. I figured, well, how bad can I be? All right, here's a song called Shit Sandwich. Go ahead, save that floats. And they'd be like, here's your song, your problem now. Yeah, that one they actually wrote back an email and just said, Shit Sandwich, Shit Sandwich. And they kept it, I think, as long as it actually got cut not for content.
Just didn't have time for it.
Yeah.
So you could like release that as a single.
Yeah, I think it's on there. They did put out a CD of that. And such a comedy story. It was a little. The guys were always talking to me about, oh, we'll put this all out as an album. So I was like, let me know because some of these should be remixed and fixed because you know it's a really quick schedule. And then of course the way stuff goes with. Corporate world, and let's get it going now. It was like it was done before I even knew what. Oh, that shouldn't have opened. Or stuff that should have been cut together, and there was a lot of little things that it is what it is.
Paul and Storm over on the end, you guys also wrote a raft of songs for your YouTube series. And let's talk about...
That's about the right amount of applause.
Let's talk a little bit about writing the songs specifically in the context of an episode.
Well, that was really a stretch of the series Learning Town was a music comedy web series.
Look it up. It's real good.
Also, if he's here, we'd have to shout out the script written by our friend Josh Kagan. You hear, Josh?
Yeah.
And, so, it was actually a bit of a stretch for us. We're accustomed to writing joke songs, songs that are designed to get the laugh, and that's pretty much what they do. Some of them have a little more emotional content, and with Learning Town, it was more difficult because we were trying to get a laugh and also have them serve the purpose of the plot. So it wasn't just going for a joke, and it was within the context of the show, which in a lot of ways makes it easier. Edwin was talking about if you're given the lyrics or a prompt that then that you or other people have agreed is funny, then it's okay, go, and you go with it. And so in that way, I kind of found that was more fun in some ways, where you weren't sitting over your keyboard thinking, come on, think of a funny idea, that it was already there. And it was just a matter of carving it out of the block of granite. It's definitely granite.
What he said.
Maybe marble. Sometimes it was marble.
Sometimes it was marble, sometimes it was granite.
I don't have too much to add to that. It certainly was an added level of difficulty because, you know, when you're writing a song for a musical, you know, one of the old saws about it is that the reason a song should be in a musical is because the characters have no choice but to burst into song because you're expressing an emotion in a way that can't really be expressed just by speaking. And while we were both fans of musicals, we had no real experience writing that. It was a very steep learning curve trying to find songs that could A, be funny and interesting, B, somehow move the plot forward, or if they're not doing that, at least C, doing that expressing of an emotion in a musical form and in an effective way. It was hard. And also, it's got to be short because every episode is no more than 8 minutes long. Which, as it turns out, was about 5 minutes too long.
Molly, I'm going to ask you specifically. I think one of your best-known songs, not necessarily one of your best songs, but one of your best-known songs, although there's nothing wrong with the song, I'm going to shut up now.
Stop calling.
it's the Stephen Fry song.
Oh, sure.
Okay. I've got some time for applause. This is all okay. Talk a little bit about the idea of A, writing a song that is A, about someone.
Sure.
That B, finds that person, and C, that you get to sing it for that actual person.
Sure. Well, that song, it came about because there's this whole story. I was dating a guy at the time who was, you know, sort of had his own opinions about what I could do with myself. And at some point I was, like, pushing that boundary one day, and I was like, what if we had, like, a friend who couldn't conceive a child? Could I have their baby? And he was like, no, that's weird. And I went, what if it was, like, a gay couple that couldn't have a baby? And he was like, no, that's not good either. And I went, what if it was Stephen Fry? And he went, yes. You have to do that. And we ended up breaking up, and I was like, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to proposition Stephen Fry, jerk. And so I wrote this song, and the song is called An Open Letter to Stephen Fry, and I structured it to be as much like a letter as possible. You know, there's sort of an opening paragraph about, like, listen, so here's your deal. I have an idea. I have a proposition for you. And it's sort of I tried to develop the idea in sort of paragraph forms, as you would in a letter. And ultimately that letter got delivered to him because I was workshopping it, like, actively at Woodstock, and the song developed over a series of Woodstocks, and it got passed on to him somehow, got passed on to some people at Harvard who were like, hey, we're having Stephen Fry over next week, so if you can get yourself to Boston, you can play it for him, and that would be pretty great. And I went, yes, okay, we'll do that. And were it not for the muscle memory of playing that song at Woodstock so many times, I would have just barfed. I wouldn't have gotten through it. But that was an odd experience because usually when I played that song, like there are some comedy songs that you really need to kind of preface with, like, so the story of this song is it's about, you know, a scientist who lives on a mountain, or it's about, you know, Mr. T becoming my life coach, or whatever the song's about. And in this one show, where I was singing to Stephen Fry at this award ceremony, I couldn't necessarily take the audience into my consideration. Like, for the one time that I've ever played that song, I had to address it directly to the person it was about. And it completely threw off my mojo. Because I'm used to being like, hey, who knows who Stephen Fry is? And in a room of people celebrating him. Obviously, that kind of goes without saying. It was sort of uniquely nerve-wracking, because I've written a couple songs about living people, and as far as I know, Stephen Fry is the only one who has heard the song of which he is the subject. I don't think Mr. T has heard his Mr. T song. I don't think Lisa Nowak has heard the Lisa Nowak song. I would certainly like to find out if she has. I don't know if that answers your question.
No, it does. It does. And it actually brings up not necessarily a person per se, but one of the uses of comedy, or one of the uses of in songwriting, is often to talk about contemporary subjects, or to make a point through satire or something along that line. One of your new songs, Jonathan, is about the guy who feels brave about being online, and so on and so forth, when in fact he's just a dick, right?
That's right.
That's right. Okay, gold star for Scalzi.
Yeah, you got it.
Well, I mean, but let's talk about that. I mean, in the sense of writing something that is satire, is meant to be commentary, what's, do you worry about pushback? I mean, it was entirely possible that Stephen Fry could have possibly been in.
I was prepared for him to punch me. I really was.
Yeah, right, exactly. When you are writing something that is meant to very specifically comment on a particular topic, do you worry about the repercussions, or you just focus on the song right then and there?
No, I mean, yeah, I feel like it's impossible these days to write anything that you plan to publish and not worry about the repercussions. That's one of the current problems with the internet. But I think that, you know, At its best, the job of songwriting is to kind of be fearless and to be able to express something, you know, especially when you're writing from, like, that song's a good example because it's, you know, it's an unreliable narrator situation. It's this guy describing his very obviously flawed perspective about how he's a sort of misunderstood genius and everybody else is an idiot and he's the only one who knows how everything should be. And yet he's also terrified and self-loathing and realizes that he's talking himself into a life of loneliness. But you know, that's the power of that kind of song, is that it's, you know, you're taking the perspective of this character who is a flawed person. But in order to do that correctly, you have to be fearless about saying some things that are kind of dickish. And, yeah, I mean, it's a thing that I worry about in the back of my mind, is that I'm going to sing a song like that and somebody's going to, and it does happen all the time, people mistake the singer for the song.
Right.
Just ask Randy Newman.
Seriously. Yeah, no.
He writes a lot of unreliable narrator type songs, and people tend to think, like, he hates short people or whatever.
That's right. So yeah, it is a tricky thing, but I think if you shy away from it, then the song is not going to be as good. If you're writing about a character who is ugly, then you have to be as ugly as you can possibly be to make it believable, true.
Well, I think with comedy and any kind of storytelling, too, like, there's this interview I saw with Stephen Sondheim where they were saying, like, oh, well, you're a poet of sorts, and he went, no, I'm not, I'm a lyricist, and there's a difference. Because with a poem, you kind of expect that people will, you know, they'll kind of walk themselves through it, they'll read back over bits they didn't understand. And if you're going to tell a story or try and convey an idea through poetry, you have to kind of let the reader go on their own journey. But with lyric, you have control over the order in which they process the ideas, and you need to build in time for them to sort of reflect on certain larger ideas. And that services, like, that kind of story, like unreliable narrative storytelling, really well, and it serves comedy really well. Like, you couldn't really, I know people write comedy poems, that's totally a thing, but you can sort of uniquely get the drop on people when you write funny songs. Like, I feel like drop rhymes don't work in poems because you go, oh, she didn't rhyme, she rhymed something with crotch, but it seemed like she was going to rhyme with another word. You know, like, You can build in, like, comedy's all about timing, and lyrics allow you to play with that timing so much.
Does the musician and lyricist of Shit Sandwich have anything to add to this particular discussion?
Well, I think there is the whole other element, too, that, you know, there is the lyrical element, where I may be making it stray a little bit, but the musical element itself can be funny, too.
Yeah, absolutely.
And so, but I'm kind of straying from the whole...
No, expand.
Okay. Because, yeah, a lot of times when I'm giving lyrics, of course, I don't get to contribute to that, and how can I support it musically? And but that affects the timing and all of those things, the rhythm of it. There are ways to make a lyric that in itself may not even be that funny, and then it becomes really silly if you do some musical twist on it. I was just working on a thing the week before coming here where it's a Hall & Oates song that's like supposed to be a long-lost Hall & Oates song for a thing. I can't name what it is. But one stupid thing in the thing is this little hand clap that keeps happening. And it just started making us laugh more and more. And it's like the hook of the song is this hand clap. It has nothing to do with the lyrics or anything else. So it's just an example of how the music itself can be funny, and it's actually a very important element, depending on what type of music it is. I mean, when you're doing it, if the song is just you and a guitar or whatever, that's one way. But when you're producing it, when it's going to be something that's got arrangement, like one thing I learned a lot, I was working with Garfunkel & Oates a lot. I don't write for them, but I arrange for them and produce some of their stuff. And one thing we would stumble on is a lot of times you get a great melodic idea in the arrangement, and it can distract from the lyric, and be like, that sounds great. And it's, again, getting back to your very original thing of, is it a good song and then it's funny? There's a lot of stuff that makes a really great song, and if the song we were working on wasn't supposed to be funny, you'd put that part in, because it's cool. But then when it's in there, you're kind of like your focus is taken off of the lyric, and you want to get that rhythm, you want to get that, you set it up away, and then that rhyme switch happens or whatever, and if you distract the focus from that, that can be, it makes it less funny.
So you're basically talking about editing.
Yeah, it's editing and just having your arrangement is servicing the comedy of it. If it's strictly a comedy song, kind of getting back to something you said earlier, there is a thing too of there's full-on comedy songs in the comedy section of the store, you know what I mean? And then there are songs that are funny that are like on somebody's album that are funny that it's not in a comedy context. So I'm talking about the ones that are really like, this is all about, it has to be super funny. And that's the main purpose of this song. So in that case, your actual surrounding music has to cater to that. And you have a lot of things you can, tricks and fun that you can pull in that regard as well.
Go ahead.
Yeah, if I can build on it, all of that evidence is so spot on. It's sort of like what you're saying about Ginger Rogers and Fred Astaire, but it's that comedy, that written comedy or comedy poetry, whatever type, has its type of rhythms. And music has its type of rhythms, but the space where the two overlap is actually very small. So that's what's hard. So we might, more often than not, we write songs from the funny idea or a funny lyric, and very rarely from a piece of music that becomes funny. There's just a very specific set that can serve both things.
Well, one of the things that I thought was, go ahead, because you clearly had a thought.
Oh no, because I know, I imagine you guys too, like, do you place jokes in songs where you know there will be a break for people to laugh so they don't step on the next joke?
Yes.
Yeah. It's everything. Timing's everything.
Timing is everything. Another thing that I think is actually kind of funny is taking a song that is not natural, that is not in and of itself funny, but making it funny because of the context. And Jonathan, one of the Baby Got Back, which is freaking hilarious because you do it as a sensitive songwriter thing when it starts off as this, you know, just great high energy rap song. It's just the fact of changing the mode of the presentation of the song is in and of itself fun.
Sure, and let me say that I was not the first to do that. You know, that I stole that idea from several other people who had taken pop songs and done them in a very sensitive way.
Right, because you're the only one that's here.
No, that's true. And I will say that I'll credit my wife Christine for making me cover that song. She's always yelling at me to cover this song or that song.
And this time she was absolutely right. She's never been right again, but that was the time. That was the time when she was absolutely right. And what convinced me was that I had never really listened to the song all that closely before, but she somehow knew all the lyrics. And what convinced me was that song is really, it's a song about liking big butts, which sounds hilarious, but it really has a very positive message about body image and... it sounds like I'm being facetious, but I'm not. And so I think one of the reasons that song worked as a genre-bending cover is that the making it a sensitive white guy, folky white guy, singing about it in this really heartfelt way, to me, pulls that message out and makes it a lot more plain than it was for me when I was listening to it, on the radio, driving to the beach or whatever. And so something about the intersection of that really heartfelt and touching sentiment, and this sensitive, croony, folky white guy, for me, that was a really nice marriage of aesthetics.
There also aren't a lot of sensitive white guy songs about butts. I feel like that's...
I'm trying to think if there's another one at all.
That's very sensitive.
Which one?
That one grows.
We're wandering.
Let's kind of tighten that up.
If I can build on that, the other thing that makes that song so effective for me and what seems to be one of Jonathan's superpowers when it comes to writing funny songs that are great is because the...
Funny songs that are great.
you get the... and this goes, I think, for any comedy song for me is the joke is there, the juxtaposition. Like the source of any humor is just, here's this unexpected thing. And okay, that was... That was some surprise, that was funny, that was great. The jokes in a comedy song generally hold up a couple of listens through. And if there's nothing else behind it, it's going to lose effectiveness quickly. And Baby Got Back, and every damn song that Jonathan writes, whether or not it's funny, it's a really good song. Like Baby Got Back is, it's beyond just the setting that's folky white guy. It's a beautiful melody. It's a wonderful arrangement of that song. And that's the thing we certainly always strive for when we're trying to write songs is... We want it to be funny, but more than that, we want it to be a good song because it's got to stand up to repeat listenability.
Yeah.
That's for us what makes it really effective. And then it's great when it's funny on top of that, but it is just as important, if not more important to us, that it be flat out a good song. Whatever that means, it's pretty, it's effective, it grabs people, it speaks emotionally, just the melody and the arrangement of whatever is underneath it.
And I will say that, first of all, thank you, that's very kind, and I think you guys, everybody here does a great job of actually writing songs when you're also writing a comedy song, and a pet peeve of mine is that, congratulations to all of us, high fives all around.
Yes.
But a pet peeve of mine is a comedy song where it's clear that somebody had the joke, had the funny idea, and started to write a comedy song and didn't actually get to the point of writing a song. It drives me nuts because it doesn't get there. It doesn't ever land. All you have is the joke, and as you said, the joke doesn't play more than a couple of times. And the real power of comedy songwriting is in the song part. And if you can accomplish that, then you've made something that is really complete and it's going to last and it's going to work on multiple levels. And it's so much greater than just telling a joke.
I actually think this is why "Clever Girl" by the Double Clicks is the perfect comedy song. Because it knows exactly how much song it needs to accomplish its joke,
God,
and bounces
yes.
the hell out. It's amazing.
That's right. Yeah.
Really skillfully executed.
Okay. I'm going to ask them one more question, and then let them go back and forth, and then we will open up to questions for you folks. Reminder for the people who were not here before, the way that we do questions is you raise your hand, you phrase your questions in the form of a question, keep it short, so that we can process as many questions as possible in the time we have allotted. One very significant strain of humorous or funny song is the parody, for example, very much like Weird Al, where he'll take an existing song, put new lyrics on it, or somebody does one in the style of somebody else. And one of the things that I remember
specifically, it's the poem Storm and Jonathan did this contest where they were in a contest where they had to write in each other's styles. Poem Storm, name the song that you guys did, the title of that, and the basic idea of it.
We wrote a song called Live, and the concept was it was a Frankenstein, Dr. Frankenstein character who had given up on finding a girlfriend and decided to build his own.
By the way, he was sad.
He was sad.
Now, Jonathan Coulton, name the song. Tell us what it's about.
My song was called Big Dick Farts a Polka.
By most measures, as in votes that actually counted in the contest, Jonathan won. But in reality, we were the ones that ended up with the song we were proud to sing in our set.
I will tell you the order in which I conceived of this song. The title came first. And then it suggested a story. It's a guy named Richard, who's baby fat, who can fart in a way that plays polka. Obviously, lives in Pennsylvania. It sort of unspools from there, and it writes itself. The second thing that occurred to me was the ending, which is da 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 da.
Pretty much even started from the ending.
Yeah. Most of our songs end with a tag and a fart sound. So.
That's what I was thinking. It's implied anyway. But speaking for myself, listening to your parody of me made my blood run cold. I felt pretty thoroughly skewered. So kudos to you.
Even like
the bridge, goddamn the bridge.
Oh, you just sort of wandered
the
around.
The bridge just modulates to this other chord, and then it sort of wanders. Kind of comes in for a landing, and then it's like,
we toured together for a great number of years, Jonathan and us, and he would often describe the bridges of his songs in that manner. That my bridges.
Whoa!
Okay, we're back.
Yeah. I had a question, but now I don't even know.
Really, write it as a joke, though. It really was, what decision would Jonathan make here? So we really were trying to construct a Jonathan Coulton song.
Right. So actually, that does bring back to the question very quickly, so that we can open up the questions. So when you are doing the parody, or when you are trying to write in the style of another writer for a comedic effect, is it harder to do because you are working with something that already exists rather than doing your own original thing?
I don't know if it's harder. It's sort of a slightly different skill set. It's you're sort of doing an imitation, and in the structure you're trying to sort of put yourself in, figure out how would they approach this thing. With that song, actually, I think it came pretty easily to us. You found the sort of the guitar riff and the feel of it.
Well, and the theme.
And the
theme is, what hasn't Jonathan done yet?
Yeah.
He's done squids, he's done zombies, what's left? Frankenstein, yes.
I don't know if it was necessarily harder, but it certainly can be. But it is definitely a slightly different skill set than just write a funny song.
Molly, anything to add in here?
Well, for me, I had to do a lot of those kind of parodies. And the most time-consuming aspect for me is just, you have to back-engineer whatever you're doing. Because in my case, it's usually, it's never the Weird Al thing. Weird Al actually pays. He does the right thing, gets the song, changes the lyrics, and the original songwriters make some money off it. In TV, they don't do that. They're like, can you write a song? Here's the parody concept. And so you have to, I'm very conservative about that. I don't want to, I want to make it like it's another song off that album. So it's musically, compositionally very different, but it's got to sound like it. So if it's an album that was recorded in the 60s, you want it to sound like that era. And so that can be time. But I think the joke isn't as funny unless it's really authentic sounding. So you spend hours trying to either find the sounds, make the sounds, figure it out, and back engineer how do they do, what was their recording. So.
Molly, anything else?
Nope.
Okay.
I should find it a little easier to do a style parody or a straight parody because that your listener already knows so much.
Right.
So it's sort of a lot of the work is already done. But then that means the rest of the work that you do from there has to be exceptionally good, and that's, I think, the genius of Weird Al, is that he is exceptionally good. Even though you know the song, he's adding a lot of new, unique things to it.
Okay, so now we're going to go for questions for the audience, and we'll start over here. Go ahead.
Probably a question you guys have answered a lot before, so I apologize if that's the case. But I'm kind of curious, since a lot of you have created a lot of content, I'm curious what song you had the most, or rather the audience had the most surprising reaction to. So like, what song you put out there and got you the most kind of unexpected reaction, and what that was, or why it was unexpected to you?
That's a great question. I think we're going to go with the song from our first band, Da Vinci's Notebook, where it's a hit of ours that really kind of kept us going into where we are, if you trace long enough. I'm delaying actually saying the name of the song. It's called Enormous Penis, which is something that Paul had written as just this funny little thing.
Right when you know.
And we knew it was funny. At the time, we didn't have, like, you know, a huge, massive following. And it was our manager convinced us to send it to radio stations randomly. And
not like just drop it there. Like,
no,
play the song.
There are methods for doing this that are known. It is known. And we were very surprised that this one radio show picked it up and that so many people would connect to it. It was early internet age, so we were suddenly getting emails from places we had never been or thought to go. Upper Michigan, and
that was it, really.
That's it, just Upper Michigan. But that,
it was surprising how that song became kind of embraced and became, you know, what we were known. We were not expecting that to be our hit.
For me, one of my favorite songs to play for audiences is "I Crush Everything," the song about the sad giant squid. Thank you. Because I can tell how many people have heard it before. It's fascinating because if it's a new audience, they will laugh at the lines that, you know, I hate my beak and the dolphins are all phonies. If it's an audience that has heard the song a few times, it's pin drop quiet. And it's the craziest thing because it is a song that the first time you hear it, you're like, oh, that's hilarious. And the 10th time you hear it, is you're like, oh my god, it's me! It's really very powerful. And so I'd love to throw that song in front of a new audience who's never heard it before and say, this is about a giant squid who hates himself, ha ha ha. And then I sing it, and they're laughing, and the laughter dies gradually over the course of the song until the end, and they're all weeping and silent. But it's like punching the audience in the face. No offense.
Oh, surprising songs. Probably the MySpace song, the first one that I wrote, because, like I said, it was a terrible slam poem. And I went, well, I have this lyricless song sitting around, what if I put these two together? And I stuck it on the internet, and then Dig found out and was like, hey, everybody, let's all watch this song at once and freak out this high schooler. And before that, I didn't think there was even an audience for that sort of thing. I didn't know why I would bother to write songs, but I had this terrible slam poem that wasn't going to get used, so might as well. And then half a million YouTube views later, I was like, maybe I should write a second song.
Welcome to your career. I think what most surprised me was a teeny little cue I did for Mystery Show. It was one of, like, a bunch I had to write in one night. And it was a parody of... They just said, we need some music in the background that teenagers would be listening to. And at the time, that song, Barbie Girl, or I'm a Barbie Girl. So it was a song like that called I'm a Party Girl. And it's my voice pitch shifted up. Just, I'm a party girl! Kind of thing. And apparently that ended up on the internet with a bunch of different animations. And I'm like, okay. So that was fun.
All right, other questions? Anyone else? Way in the back, yell it.
I can yell it, it's okay.
Yeah!
What song was the most arduous to write, and what was the easiest to write?
What was the easiest? We're going to start on this end first, yeah, because you always get to start.
well, arduous, and it was terrible. I did a song that was for the movie Dumb and Dumberer with Harry Met Lloyd.
It's a classic.
Which, my whole experience was something else. I did a score for that, and then there was this song, and it was one of those ones where from the beginning they go, we want you to do this song, and they knew what they wanted to be about. It was basically exactly what they'd already done on South Park with Chef a bunch of times. It's like, okay. So, I think I did almost 19 versions of it, and it was one of these things where the very first version I did, the director took it and played it, laughed at this a couple places, and hey, you listen to this, and they laughed at a couple places. So the first round of notes, and they were all in the same places. Those places are too on the notes. Take those out, change it, and then it changed and changed and notes and changed, and it was just a complete nightmare. And then we thought we got it okay, where me and a choreographer that was working on it, we worked together where certain moves would happen with certain lyrics, so it was a combination of what was happening on screen with the lyrics would be the joke, and then at the last minute they went, oh, we're not going to do any of that stuff now, we're just going to have them go down a hallway and sing it. Oh, hey, so then there's no jokes. And then it got, then when they broke the news to me that it got cut from the movie, it was like I had to fake having any pain about it. Because I was like, yes, I'm gone. That would have been the end of me. So that was arduous. The easiest was probably that La 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 song.
As it would be.
Yes, of course. Just get, look on the internet for how many terms there are for vagina. There's my verse. It's done.
Molly.
I respect that. I mean, probably the easiest song that I've written was also very labial in its theme, because Cards Against Humanity asked me to write a song about literally anything in this deck of theirs for their Christmas pack, and one of them was the Hawaiian goddess Kapo, who has a flying detachable vagina, and I was like, that's on brand, I'll take that. And it was like short, and I'd already gotten paid for it, so does it have verses? I don't know. Does it have a bridge? Who cares? It all just came out at once. I think the hardest, the most arduous one was a song that I wrote for Thanksgiving versus Christmas, which is a musical that I wrote with Josh Wave. I wrote a song for my friend Nicole Deeger, who is a friend of the boat, and I tried to write, I was trying to write basically Not Getting Married Today from Company, but about Christmas, and so it's got like 5 A rhymes in every paragraph, and it was the last song I finished like a couple weeks away from the show, and I don't myself. But I'm really proud of it, and you should all get Thanksgiving versus Christmas and listen to it, so I didn't have to write that song for nothing.
I think they all feel arduous when I am working on them, and the more separation I have from them in time, the easier I remember them being. So it's hard to say, but the I feel like one of the really easy ones was the Portal song. Which, for whatever reason, the character of GLaDOS was just so clear to me. I just knew exactly who she was. I felt like I could channel her voice so easily, maybe because she and I share the same penchant for annoying passive-aggressive behavior. But that one, you know, once I had kind of talked to the writers and once I had played the game and heard her talk through the game, it just came right out. It was very easy. In reference to the way I started this answer, I will say the most arduous song was the last song I wrote for my new album, because it was the last one I had to write for the album, and I didn't think I could do it, and it took a long time, because I had a lot of blockage about it, but it's done!
Thank you. Not necessarily the most arduous, but it took the longest in recent memory was the Irish sing-along song. Because it didn't start out. Originally, it started out. We had the idea of can we write like a pre-forgotten sing-along song? Like dude was stoned and remembers this song that was awesome, and everybody sang along but couldn't remember what the words were. And we took a few different swings at that over the course of probably about 2 years, and we put it away a while and tried again and put it away, and finally, eventually hit on the Irish sing-along aspect of it, and that it felt like it had enough meat on the bones finally.
Yeah, it's actually rare for us to work arduously on a thing because we're, no, really, because if if we'll usually truncate it. If there's only that much humor there, we'll go with that, because there's a term in comedy that you're doing something, you're sweaty. You can hear the writer in it, where, oh, I have to have a third verse, and that third verse is going to be terrible. So that's why. And this was a rare case where we loved the idea so much, but we just hadn't found the right hook for it when we did. Then it was easy. I think the easiest thing, and it happens for us a lot, where we're just so giddy and happy and excited, and it just spills out. But like the short songs, the commercials, the one sentence, if James Taylor were on fire.
All right, and that's all the time that we have. Sorry, everybody, no more questions. But I want to thank all of the folks up on the panel. Storm, Paul, thank you all for coming. Remember, here you are going to teach any man how to be a nerd. Is that coming up next? And it's coming up next, so stick around for that. All right, thank you, everyone.